All right, so let's go forward. So we're talking about crystal structures, and where we left last time was just an example of sodium chloride, how we can account for the number of atoms that are present in the unit cell. Remember that the unit cell is the smallest unit of the crystal that we can reproduce the entire crystal by just translating the unit cell through all space. And what I mean by translation is that, you know, this is the unit cell edge. The lattice constant here would be some value in angstroms. And if we took this as the origin of the unit cell and we, let's say, added a second unit cell over here, we just translate by one lattice constant and reproduce the unit cell right here. We translate by another lattice constant and reproduce it a third time, and so forth, infinitely in that direction and in the reverse direction, and in fact in all three dimensions in space. And so by translation through an infinite set of lattice constants, in this case A equals B equals C, so they're all the same, okay, we can generate the entire crystal. Okay? So this second unit cell that would exist over here would have, you know, translation just by that distance. So this atom would move there, this atom would move there, this atom would move there, etc. Okay? And so you can see how you would then replicate the entire crystal, and it would be, you know, the sort of periodic repeating pattern that we've talked about. Okay? What we want to do today is discuss actual crystal structures in a little bit of detail, and in particular we're going to focus on something called the close-packed structures, okay, as a way of actually understanding a lot of different kinds of crystals in terms of taking a close-packed array of usually anions, the big members of an ionic crystal, and then stuffing them with in the interstitial spaces with cations. Okay? So that's what we're going to go toward today. Let's remember the three different kinds of cubic lattices that we've talked about so far: the simple cubic, the BCC, and the FCC. There are various important things that we would want to understand about the basic geometry of these kinds of crystals, and those things are kind of listed here. Okay? Previously, we talked about the number of atoms per unit cell. It's either 1, 2, or 4, going from simple cubic to face-centered cubic. Another important parameter is, what is the bonding like in these sorts of lattices, okay, in these sorts of Bravais lattices? Well, you can describe that in terms of the coordination number, which is just the number of nearest neighbors or the number of atoms that I'm bound to, okay, if I'm at a given position in the lattice. And you can see here that if you're any of these lattice positions, you have 6 nearest neighbors. Okay? So let's say that we're this lattice position here. The 6 nearest neighbors are this one, which is a distance away, this one, which is also a, this one, and then we have 3 more, one on top, one on the left, and one in front of this lattice position. And that gives us an octahedral kind of symmetry. That's a coordination number of 6. The number of nearest neighbors is 6. This is different in BCC. So if we look at body-centered cubic, the easiest position to see is the body-centered position here, which you can clearly see has 8 nearest neighbors. Okay? The 8 nearest neighbors are inscribed in the corners of a cube. Okay? So that's our coordination number of 8. And then the face-centered cubic, a little bit more difficult to see. This is the most densely packed structure. So it has a coordination number of 12. We can see that perhaps by looking at this atom position here. This guy has these 4 nearest neighbors that are sort of in this plane here. And then there are 4 nearest neighbors on the right-hand side. And equivalently, if we reproduce the other unit cell here, we'd find that these positions move right here, and so there'd be 4 more. So we'd have 4, 4, and then the 4 that we haven't drawn in, giving us 12. And all of those are located exactly the same distance away, which is, you know, half of the face diagonal of the unit cell. So the number of nearest neighbors is very important, 6, 8, and 12. That corresponds to a packing fraction, okay? Packing fraction meaning if we consider these lattice positions to be incompressible spheres and we pack spheres together, what is the total space filling fraction of the spheres? Okay? That is the amount of space filled by the spheres divided by the amount of space, total space in the cube of the unit cell. The packing fraction increases from 52% to 68% to 74%. 74% is the maximum packing fraction that one can have if you take single-sized incompressible spheres and try to organize them in 3 dimensions. Okay, you cannot get more packing fraction than 74. It's actually 74.05%. Okay? So we call this face-centered cubic structure a close-packed structure because it's close-packed in the sense that you can't get any denser. What about the lattice constant? We can relate the lattice constant, A, right, the length of the unit cell edge, to the radius of the atoms that are present in each of these different structures. And we can do that in the following way. If we consider the simple cube, and we consider packing of incompressible spheres, meaning that they come and they touch, and they don't compress, they don't deform, okay? Then the unit cell edge, this distance here, is just going to be 2 radii. Okay? So we have one radius from this atom at the corner, another radius from this atom at the corner. They touch right there along the midway on that edge. And so the lattice constant is the same as 2 times the radius for a simple cube. Okay? This is different for the BCC and the FCC structures. So if we look at BCC, we painted in the three-dimensional kind of close packed arrangement diagram here, so we can actually see what's going on. What we notice that's interesting is that along the edge of the unit cell, the atoms no longer touch. Okay? The direction of touching, of just perfect touching, is along the so-called body diagonal of the unit cell. That is from one corner of the unit cell to an opposite corner. So this one going through the middle of the cube and to the back corner on the bottom. That's the body diagonal direction. There's a bunch of body diagonals, so here's another one that passes this direction, right? Here's another body diagonal here. And what you see is that that's exactly the perfect touching direction for BCC lattice. And if you count up the number of radii along the body diagonal, you find that there are 4 radii, right? So you see, let's go from this body diagonal here, you can see 1 radius, and then there's a diameter, so that's 2 radii, and then there's another radius. And so we have 4 radii spanning the body diagonal. We can relate the body diagonal length to the unit cell edge. The body diagonal length is just A times root 3. Okay? And so the total lattice constant then is going to be 4 radii divided by root 3. And you can, you can draw a little cube and work this out, make sure that geometrically you understand how this comes about. But this is how we can relate the radius of the atom to the unit cell edge, okay, the lattice constant. Finally, we have the FCC structure, okay? A little bit more complicated. So just like in BCC, the touching direction is not along the edge, okay? But unlike BCC, the touching direction is not along the body diagonal anymore. It's along the face diagonal. Okay? So just going from one opposite corner to the, one corner to the opposite corner here along one of the faces. And you can see that, again, we have 4 radii. We have 1 radius, we have a diameter, and then we have another radius. In this case, we have 4 radii. The length is actually A times root 2. That's the face diagonal length. And so the overall distance, the unit cell edge, is going to be 4r divided by root 2. In other words, it's 2r times root 2. Okay. So again, this is how we can relate the actual contents, right, the atomic radii, to the unit cell parameter. What we're going to focus on for the rest of the lecture today are these close-packed structures. Okay, these structures like the FCC structure that has maximum packing fraction of 74%. Okay. The reason that we're going to do this is because this is a powerful approach to actually understanding a whole host of different kinds of crystals, okay, more complicated crystals than those that just have a single atom within them. So we need to consider, first of all, how we make a close-packed structure. If we wanted to pack three-dimensional space with the densest number of incompressible spheres of all the same size, how would we do that? Well, it turns out that it can be mathematically proven that the easiest way to do that in two dimensions, the only way to do that in two dimensions, is to make a hexagonal array that looks like this. This is called a hexagonal close-packed, or HCP, structure. And in two dimensions, you just organize your spheres so that they produce this kind of hexagon. This guy has 6 nearest neighbors around him. Infinite two-dimensional sheet of this stuff gives you an HCP sheet. And then the way that we make three-dimensional structures is we just stack these HCP layers in different sequences. And we'll describe 2 of the most important sequences in just a second. If we stack in certain sequences two-dimensional HCP arrays, we can get structures that look like this. Okay, this is called a cubic close-packed structure. We'll show how we derive this in just a second. But you can see that it's familiar shape, it's a tetrahedron, and it looks highly organized. That's as dense as you can get, okay, with just a single structure, single size. And as always, what we're talking about in this class are going to be crystals that look like this, rather than amorphous solids, which would look like something, if you took an object that doesn't have perfect shape, has distribution and size and shape, and tried to stack it in the same way, you get something that looks a lot more disorganized, like this pile of oranges. So the reason that this happens, of course, is because the atoms are perfect. Each one is exactly the same as the other. Okay. So let's look at two important close-packed structures. The first is called the hexagonal close-packed, or HCP, structure. Okay. How do we go about building this? The HCP crystal is just a close-packed structure with a repeat sequence of the hexagonal two-dimensional layers of AB, 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 infinitely reproduced. Okay. So it's an ABA repeat sequence. Let's see how we build it. Okay. Let's take just a section. This is just a piece of an infinite two-dimensional sheet that's HCP. You can see that we have holes, right? These are depressions. If you imagine these as spheres, these are depressions where additional objects that would sit on top could rest. Okay. Let's now add a second layer, just to another HCP layer, just to one. It turns out there are two different ways we could do this, right? But just to one set of the holes. Okay. And so this second layer, because it rests in these interstitial spaces or these little depressions, doesn't lie directly over the first layer. You can see that, you know, it lies over these holes. So we would call that position B, or orientation B, right, relative to orientation A, which was the first layer. Now, the critical question comes about, what do we do with the third layer? If we're going to build up a three-dimensional structure, what happens, you know, depending on where we put this third layer? It turns out there are two different sets of holes that we could put the third layer. Okay? One set of holes is given by these squares here, so we could put, you know, a third layer there, and, you know, close-packed HCP with the center of the spheres at those positions. Or we could put the center of the spheres at those positions that are inscribed by triangles. Okay? Let's say that we do the latter, okay, and we put the third layer where these triangles are. That is directly over the first layer, directly over that blue layer that you see. Okay? And so here's our third layer, just a piece of it, just to keep it so you can actually visualize what's happening. But remember, these are all infinite two-dimensional planes that we're organizing here. If we do this, then the third layer and the first layer are directly on top of one another along this axis that is coming out of the board. Okay? And so we would call this the A, the B, which is different than the A, and then we're back to the A. Okay? And if we repeat this infinitely, this sequence of A, B, A, B, A, B, we get something that in a three-dimensional projection looks like this. Okay? This is just three layers. Here's a part of the A layer. Here's a part of the B layer above it, and here's another part of the third layer, the A layer above that B layer. It turns out that if you do this, you generate the hexagonal close-packed structure. Its filling fraction is 74%, and we can understand it as two interpenetrating simple hexagonal lattices, that is, two interpenetrating Bravais lattices that are hexagonal, in which the lattices are displaced from one another by this vector. Okay? One-third of A, one-third of B, or one-third of A1, let's say, one-third of A2, and one-half of A3. And that's this vector right here. Okay, so this would be the origin. Here's A1 distance, here's A2 distance, and here's A3 distance. Right? And remember, in a hexagon, A1 and A2 are the same. A3 is going to be longer or shorter, okay? Usually longer for a close-packed structure. Okay, so this gives us the hexagonal close-packed array. We can understand that it is not a Bravais lattice. Remember, the definition of a Bravais lattice is that at every single lattice point, my world looks exactly the same. And that's not true in this case, because if you stood here and looked up and forward, you would see two atoms in front of you. But if you stood here at another lattice point and looked up and in the same direction, you'd see only one lattice point. It's because the alternate layers are of opposite orientation. Okay, there's a rotation of the hexagon every other layer. And so because the orientation alternates, it's not a Bravais lattice. But we can still describe it as Bravais in terms of having two interpenetrating Bravais lattices. Okay? That's always the case. We have 12 nearest neighbors. Okay? It's the same as the FCC structure, because FCC is close-packed, HCP is close-packed. So both of them must have 12 nearest neighbors, and both of them must have 74% filling fraction. Can we see the 12 nearest neighbors? Well, if we stand here, we have 6 nearest neighbors in plane. We have 3 above in this triangle, and we have 3 below in that triangle. And it turns out that they're all the same distance away from us. Okay. And as I mentioned, it has the maximum packing fraction, which is why it's called a close-packed structure. Okay. So this is the hexagonal flavor of close-packed. You might guess that we also have a cubic flavor of close-packed structures. So let's see how we can generate, well, Let me back up for a second here. HCP is really important crystal structure for elemental solids. And so many structures, over 30 elements, adopt the HCP structure, including these and these over here. And what you'll see in this table, number of different elements, the A lattice constant and the C lattice constant. Remember, the C is the direction perpendicular to the HCP layers. And then there's a ratio of C over A. The ideal ratio for incompressible hard spheres is 1.63. And you can see that many of these structures come close to the ideal situation. In reality, of course, atoms and ions are compressible. They're deformable. And so they don't act in particular like hard spheres. Okay. It's an idealization, but it's a useful one. OK, so that's HCP. How do we do CCP? This is cubic close-packed. Okay. Cubic close-packed structure, instead of having an ABABAB repeat sequence, has an ABC, ABC, ABC repeat sequence. And you might imagine how we can generate this. We have layer A, we put down layer B in the same way we did before, and then we had our choice. We could put the next layer either in the triangle positions, which is what we did for the hexagon, right, the hexagonal close packing, or alternatively, we could put the next layer centered on these square positions. And you can see if we center them on the square positions, they're in a new orientation that we previously haven't used. Okay? They're not overlying either layer B or layer A. And so we put them where we have the squares, and that's this orange layer, this partial layer. We call that layer C, okay, because it has a different center point. And then we repeat ABC, ABC, ABC forever. And what that generates for us is a cubic close-packed structure in which we have the stacking of the HCP layers along the body diagonal. So this would be A, this would be B, this would be C, and then this would be A again. And you'd repeat along the body diagonal direction. That's the so-called close packing direction, okay? The direction perpendicular to the body diagonal. This is the cubic close pack structure, but we've seen this structure before. We already have seen it. It's also called the face-centered cubic. Okay? It's the exact same thing as the face-centered cubic Bravais lattice. So when you see cubic close pack, CCP, or FCC, the face-centered cubic, those are synonyms, okay? Talking about the same thing. We already know that the packing fraction is 74%. We already know that the coordination number is 12. Okay? And we can look and determine that quite easily. Okay? Here's a comparison of HCP and CCP, or FCC, the same thing, CCP, FCC, with a different color coding that might help you visualize the layer stacking sequence a little bit more easily. So in this case, ABA, that corresponds to this and corresponds to the coloration of the atoms inscribed in the unit cell. And the same thing here, ABC. So we have, in this case, ABC, A, and so forth, layers. And so these atoms here correspond to the atom coloration in the unit cell diagram. So it can help you see. The CCP is a little bit different, a little bit difficult, because we're looking not at one of the cubed faces or some simple direction, but something that's a little bit more complicated, looking at the body diagonal direction. Okay. So these are two different ways of making close-packed structures, but there are actually an infinite number of stacking sequences that one could see in nature, and those would all be close-packed. So for example, silicon carbide is a material, which is just silicon carbon one-to-one stoichiometry. SIC, okay, that has over 250 different stacking sequences that are known. These different stacking sequences lead to different crystals, lead to different properties. They're called polytypes when you have a compound material like this. One example of an important kind of silicon carbide is the so-called 6H silicon carbide. And what this notation means is that we have a stacking layer involving six different layers, stacking sequence involving six different layers. And the overall symmetry is hexagonal. And the stacking sequence in this particular case is ABC, ACB, ABC, ACB, over and over and over. You can probably understand that by changing the stacking sequence, you're not going to change the space filling fraction, but you will change the crystal itself, right? You'll get different symmetry, you'll have different reactivity, you'll have different stability, physical and chemical properties will be different. So this is quite common, actually. Okay, in metallic solids, these elemental solids, especially on the metal side of the periodic table, when we're talking about transition metals and main group metals and so forth, adopt very commonly one of these simple cubic structures. Not simple cubic, I mean, but one of the straightforward cubic structures. Okay. Very commonly, close-packed, cubic close-packed, or hexagonal close-packed, and sometimes BCC. And so we have a little periodic table here of the different crystal structures for these different elements. This color, this green, is HCP. This little darker green is FCC. And then we have BCC in the blue. Okay. So you can see that this is quite commonly observed for simple elemental solids. A metallic solid is one type of solid we're not going to talk much about, but just to mention a few things about it. Right? Metal bonding is involved in a metallic solid in which you have delocalized electrons spreading out over the entire solid and forming a kind of a sea of electrons that binds the ions together, that binds the nuclei together. Metallic bonding is a little bit, it's quite a lot stronger than van der Waals bonding, of course, but weaker than covalent bonding. And so if you look at a van der Waals solid, krypton gas, it's just formed at very, very low temperatures. You see that the melting point of krypton solid is negative 157. Okay. Copper has a much higher melting point, okay, because the bonding in it is much stronger, so about 1100 degrees, but it's nothing close to carbon, like diamond, where you have a melting point of over 3500 degrees Celsius. And that's because the bonding in carbon is so extremely strong, it's a nice covalent solid, as we'll describe. So we're not going to say much more about metallic solids, but we're going to move on and talk about mostly covalent and ionic solids, which are of extreme interest in lots of different technology. And so that's kind of my research area, and so that's one of the things we'll focus on here. Okay, so we're going to describe ionic crystals and some other kinds of crystals in terms of taking a close-packed array, a CCP or an HCP array, usually of anions, and filling some of the open space within that array with cations. So we said that 74% of the space is filled. That means 26% of the space is empty. And you can, using small enough cations, stick cations in those open spaces and make compounds. Okay? Let's understand what those open spaces look like. It turns out that for every anion in the CCP or HCP array, there's going to be one open space that has octahedral symmetry and two open spaces, two interstitial sites, that have tetrahedral symmetry. And we can see why this would be the case fairly easily if we just look at this diagram here. Okay? This shows a partial layer, HCP, underneath another partial layer that just shows one atom, okay, of, let's say, layer B. If you see, this atom here rests in this little nook between the other three. Okay? And together, they form the corners of a tetrahedron. If you were to stick a little cation in this interstitial hole, okay, you would have tetrahedral site. You would have tetrahedral symmetry. You'd have that cation binding to four anions. Okay? And so this is called a tetrahedral site or tetrahedral hole. And in this particular case, we would call this probably a tetrahedral site pointed up at us because the apex is pointed out of the board. There's also tetrahedral sites that are pointed in the opposite direction, 180 degrees rotated. We call that tetrahedral down, or T minus, perhaps. Okay? In this case, the layer that's solid circles is on top of the layer that's in dashed circles. And you can see, again, if you put an object right there, you'd have it in a tetrahedral orientation. But this case, the apex will be pointed into the board. Okay? And so we would want to distinguish between T up and T down sites. You could call them whatever you want, but usually it's up and down. Okay, T plus, T minus. So those are tetrahedral sites within the cavities that have tetrahedral symmetry. There are also cavities that have octahedral symmetry. And we can see that by looking at a different configuration of two layers. This layer here in the light line is behind the layer in the dark lines. But if you look at this particular hole that lines up between this layer of three and the layer of three underneath it, this particular hole has octahedral symmetry. You can see it has six nearest neighbors, and you can visualize the octahedral symmetry in several different ways, right? This is either the one face of the octahedron and then the other face is behind, okay? Or you can imagine this is the top, this is the bottom, and these four atoms here are in plane. Okay? But this little position here is an octahedral cavity. And if we stick something there, it's going to have six nearest neighbors, and it's going to have octahedral symmetry, which is why we call these, of course, octahedral and tetrahedral holes. How many do we have for every anion, and how can we tell? Well, like I said, there's one octahedral site per anion and two tetrahedral sites per anion. We can see that by looking at a little bit bigger section of these two layers. If we just choose a random anion like this one here, okay, we can assign to this anion two tetrahedral sites, this one that's pointed down and this one that's pointed up, and let's say this octahedral site that's right here, right, that's in the nook between these two layers, that's right here. This next anion here would have that tetrahedral site and that one and that octahedral site. This one here would have that tetrahedral, and that octahedral, and so forth. And if we count it up, just like that, we find that we have two tetrahedral, one octahedral site per anion. Those are the available sites for filling with cations. And those are the available sites for making different kinds of ionic compounds. The sizes of the octahedral and tetrahedral holes are shown here. The tetrahedral site has a radius that's about 22.5% that of the anion radius. And the octahedral site is bigger, about 41.4% of the anion radius. Okay, that's the radius of the octahedral site. Okay. Let's visualize these a little bit in more detail using three-dimensional drawings of the CCP and also the HCP. We'll get to it in a second. So here's a three-dimensional drawing of a cubic close-packed or FCC unit cell. And the easiest octahedral hole to see, okay, is in the center of the unit cell. In this particular case, actually, it's shaded so that you can see the octahedron really nicely. Okay? How many octahedral sites should we have? Well, you got to count up how many actual atoms that we have here, right? And then determine exactly how many octahedral sites you should have. We have four atoms in the FCC, and so we have four anions. We should have then four octahedral sites per unit cell. Okay? This is one at the body center position. The easiest way to do this is to call this the origin and then use these other three sites here as the other octahedral sites. This one's easy to see at the body center position. This one's, you know, these three at the edge centers are a little bit more difficult to see, but if we focus on this one here, it has these two nearest neighbors, that one behind, this one on top, one in front, and one underneath that we haven't painted in. Same thing here. This one has these two, this on top and bottom, and then there's two more that we haven't painted in over here, and so forth. Why do we pick these four, okay, with these coordinates here? It's because it's kind of the simplest, the most convenient. If we translate the unit cell and we translate also the octahedral site ownership, then we can reproduce exactly all of the octahedral sites without any overlap. Okay? So for example, if we translate the unit cell one over, this octahedral site is accommodated here, this one, would be accommodated by this other unit cell. This one here would go here, right? And so this octahedral site would then be accounted for and so forth. Okay. These are the coordinates based on an origin right there. Okay, so we have coordinates that we usually use as just fractions of a unit cell edge. So 1/2, 1/2, 1/2 would be 1/2, 1/2, 1/2 in the middle of the unit cell. And then 1/2 way along the three different axes, there, there, and there. Those are the octahedral positions. Okay, so we have four octahedral sites per cubic close packed unit cell. How many tetrahedral sites must we have? Well, we must have double that because we have two tetrahedrons per anion. So we have eight total tetrahedral sites. And where are they? Well, they're shown here. Okay, they're at the 1/4 and 3/4 combinations in the unit cell. So for example, we have a site right here, which is 1/4, 1/4, 1/4. And we would call this one here, 1/4, 1/4, 1/4, a T down site, just because the apex is pointed in this negative direction here. And so we shade it green in this case. Okay. There are three other T down sites, one's here, and one in the back that you can't see, okay, with those particular coordinates. We also have T up sites. One easy one to see is the 3/4, 3/4, 3/4 position, this one here. And that's pointed with the apex in the opposite direction. So that's why we just call it positive tetrahedron. You can see why these are tetrahedral sites, because if I put an atom right there, a cation, it has, of course, four nearest neighbors arranged in a tetrahedron. And so what we're going to be doing here is taking cubic close packed anion arrays and filling some fraction of the octahedral and tetrahedral sites with cations. When we fill, you know, all of the octahedral sites, we're going to get crystal type 1. When we fill half of the tetrahedral sites, we'll get another kind of crystal, and so forth. This shows exactly what we just did. Okay, so this is the CCP showing all of the octahedral sites. Okay. Another way to draw this is just a projection, a two-dimensional projection. This is called a plan view diagram. And so this is taking this cube here, just looking down on one face of it, and assigning these coordinates based on, again, fractional unit cell coordinates, okay, fractional lattice constants, of basically where these individual holes are. Okay. So in this position here, this is the back edge. That's one half of a unit cell up. Okay, that's why it's given one half. When you're given no label here, this indicates that we have that hole at the 0 and 1 unit cell up position. Okay, basically, at every unit cell translation, we have this position. So this one here is in the back. So we have a hole here at the 0, and we have a hole 1 unit cell away. And that's why we don't give it any numbers. Plan view diagrams are a nice, convenient way to visualize exactly where everything is without having to draw the three-dimensional structure. Okay, so we've shown for CCP. With HCP, we're not going to dwell on HCP, but it's the same idea. It's just a little bit harder to see because we don't have these mutually orthogonal Cartesian coordinates. The locations for the octahedral sites in HCP is this particular position. Okay, we have two octahedral holes here, one at 1/4 and one at 3/4. That's shown right here. These two are the octahedral holes. This is the full hexagon, okay? But you can also describe hexagonal symmetry by just taking 1/3 of the hexagon, because the different thirds of the hexagon are all the same by symmetry. And so all we've done here is looked at this third of the hexagon and then put it in a plan view or projection kind of view. Okay? So that's why we can see these two atoms right here. The anions are not painted in, just for simplicity. It's just showing where the octahedral sites are. Again, for the tetrahedral sites, we have the three-dimensional drawing. We have the plan view drawing, okay? 1/4 and 3/4 positions. Fairly straightforward to see. With HCP, it's a little bit more difficult to see, as always. In this case, again, we take 1/3 of the hexagon, and we see that we have tetrahedral holes that are located 3/8 of a unit cell above and below every single anion that's in the structure. So, for example, this 1/8 and 7/8 is this tetrahedral hole and this one here. This is painted with negative and positive. So we've got 1/8 and 7/8, and that's just 3/8 above one of these and 3/8 below the other one. We're not going to focus a lot on trying to visualize tetrahedral holes in HCP, but if you are interested, you can take a look at this and try to understand exactly how this makes sense. Okay? So the tetrahedral sites are just directly above and below the anion sites. Okay, so let's get to the main business here. We want to generate crystal structures using this approach of close-packed interstitial filling. This is a table from a book on solid-state chemistry that shows how if you take a CCP anion arrangement or an HCP anion arrangement and fill a certain number of the interstitial sites, you get a number of different common crystal structures. So for example, if we take a CCP arrangement, cubic close-packed arrangement, and we fill none of the tetrahedral sites, none of the upper town tetrahedral sites, only the octahedral sites, and we fill all of them 100%, then we get something called sodium chloride or rock salt structure, which we've already shown. Okay? If we fill none of the octahedral sites and just half of the tetrahedral sites, either the ones that are up or the ones that are down, it doesn't matter, we get something called zinc blend, okay, which is also called sphalerite crystal, and so forth. We can generate a lot of things that you've seen before here. Okay? We're going to focus just on four of these. Okay? I want to show how we can make the sodium chloride, the zinc blend, this important structure called fluorite or antifluorite, and then one HCP structure, which is the zinc sulfide hexagonal version, which is called wurtzite. These are some of the simplest cubic and hexagonal structures and also the most important technologically. So let's look at the sodium chloride structure first. Sodium chloride we can describe very nicely as CCP with all the octahedral sites filled. And so that gives us the unit cell that looks like this in a three-dimensional drawing. Perspective diagram. This is the plan view drawing of the same thing. okay? Indicating, again, when you see numerals here, this one pointed to the blue circle, which is the chloride, showing that it's halfway up in the back. That's this atom right here. Nothing pointed at the red, the sodiums, right? Indicating that there's a sodium at one unit cell up and at the zero position as well. Okay? So that's how you can read the plan view diagram. An important thing to also consider in three-dimensional structures is how can you describe them in terms of linked polyhedra? Okay, this is often a very nice way of understanding how structures are put together and what the bonding looks like in different crystals. And so in this particular case, this is the polyhedral representation of sodium chloride, which we'll get to in a minute. Okay? If we look at the coordination of the cations and the anions in the structure, remember the anions are these bigger spheres and the cations are smaller ones, we see that the coordination for both is the same. Okay? We have a coordination number of 6, and both have octahedral symmetry. Okay? So you have the cations surrounded by 6 anions and vice versa. The connectivity, the three-dimensional connectivity that we can understand is edge-sharing octahedra. Okay, so you have these particular octahedra, which are basically sodium in the middle and chlorides at the outside. So this is one octahedron here. And they're linked by edges. So all of the edges within the structure are interconnected. Okay? And so we can understand a little bit about how the structure can be built by using simple polyhedra and linking them all together in different fashion. Sodium chloride structure is found extensively in especially the alkali halides, okay? Also in the divalent metal oxides and some other structures. So magnesium oxide is rock salt. Here's the alkali halides, right? Lots of those are all rock salt, and there are others. Okay? So very common crystal structure. That's why it's an important one that we touch upon. Okay. If we go back to the CCP array and we fill only one half of the tetrahedral sites, no octahedral sites at all, then we get a different crystal structure. And this one is called zinc blend structure. It's also called sphalerite structure. So this is CCP arrangement of the anions, which you can see. It's a face-centered cube of the anions in yellow. And we've added only half of the 8 possible tetrahedral sites. And all of these tetrahedral sites are in the same orientation. They all have an apex pointed this direction. Okay. When we do this, this is the three-dimensional drawing. Here's the plan view, and here's the polyhedral representation. We have a coordination number, you can see very, very easily, for the cation of 4. It's tetrahedral coordination. It's the same thing for the anion, which is a little bit more difficult to see in this particular drawing. But the anion has also got 4 nearest neighbors, and it's tetrahedrally coordinated. The connectivity of the polyhedra is basically the corners are shared. So we have one polyhedron, here's another, here's a third, here's a fourth, and all of the vertices are linked together. Okay? None of the edges are shared, none of the faces are shared, it's just vertex-linked tetrahedra. The zinc blend structure is enormously important in semiconductor physics and semiconductor devices. So some of the most important semiconductors like gallium arsenide adopt this structure. There are many that you may not have heard of that are in things like infrared detection, right, that are used in astronomy and used for various purposes. Mercury telluride is one of those. Boron nitride is a ceramic material with very interesting properties. So you can see that there are lots of important materials that adopt this particular structure. Okay. Again, very common. Okay, so we've got CCP arrangement filling all the octahedral sites, giving us rock salt, filling half the tetrahedral sites, giving us zinc blend. The last of the cubics that we want to look at in this way is the fluorite structure, which is historically calcium fluoride. And this is the first structure that we're looking at that has a non-1-to-1 stoichiometry. Okay, the stoichiometry here is 2-to-1. We can have fluorite, which is the archetypal material calcium fluoride. We can also have the inverse, where the cation and anion positions change. This is called antifluorite, and lithium oxide is the archetypal material for antifluorite structures. So what is the fluorite structure? The fluorite structure is simply taking CCP of the cations, in this case, and filling all the tetrahedral sites with the very small fluoride anion. So that's shown here. So we have a CCP array of the dark blue calciums, and we have all 8 sites, tetrahedral sites, filled with fluoride. Okay. This gives us necessarily a 2-to-1 stoichiometry because there are twice as many tetrahedral sites as there are anions in the lattice. Okay? So that gives us our 2-to-1. It also is the first example here where we have different bonding between the anion and the cation. Okay? So the coordination is going to be 8 for the cations and only 4 for the anions. The coordination for the cations is going to look cubic, so the fluorines are at the corners of a cube. The anion coordination is tetrahedral, so all the fluorines are tetrahedral holes, so they have to be tetrahedral symmetry. And if we look at the connectivity, we can think about it in a couple different ways, as we could have before, but here it's more interesting. We can think about it as the polyhedra that have a cation at the center or the polyhedra with an anion at the center, and we're going to get kind of different structure. So if we look at the fluorine-based tetrahedra, we can see that they're going to be edge-sharing tetrahedra. So here's the fluorine-based picture. Fluorine's at the center of each of these tetrahedra, and the edges are all shared, okay? Which is different from what we've seen before. It's in a sense, it's a denser kind of structure. Alternatively, we can think about the calcium-based polyhedra. The calciums are going to be cubes, because we have fluorines. We have 8 fluorines at the corner of a cube. And in this particular case, I'll show you in the next slide, they're going to be edge-sharing cubes that are replicated through all space. We can count it up, but it should be fairly straightforward to see that we have 4 formula units of calcium fluoride. Okay? We had 4 formula units of sodium chloride. We, you know, just fill in this case the tetrahedra holes and the tetrahedral holes instead of the octahedral holes, and we're going to get double the number of fluorine. So we're going to have still 4 formula units calcium fluoride, okay, in the structure. Why do we get fluorite versus anti-fluorite? Well, it depends on which one's larger. Okay. In this case, calcium is larger than the very, very small fluoride ion. In this case, lithium is very small compared to the fairly large oxygen anion. And so that's why one or the other forms the lattice, and then the other partner forms fills into the holes. So you can see divalent fluorides are very commonly found in the fluorite structure. And then a lot of elements that involve lithium, very small cations, or even sodium with larger anions are going to adopt this structure. Okay, I showed before that we can think about fluoride in terms of a kind of a calcium-based picture here, okay, which gives us an emphasis on the coordination environment of the fluorines. An alternate way to see it, of course, is to use an origin where we have fluorine at the origin instead of calcium. So if we translate the unit cell by just 1/4 of a body diagonal, right? If we put the origin instead of here, if we put it here, then we generate a so-called B-centered cell, where B is the second atom in the structure, in this case fluorine, okay? And we get the fluorite B diagram here. So with the fluorine at the origin, this now emphasizes the calcium coordination, and so here are those edge-sharing calcium cubes that I mentioned in the previous slide. So we can look at either the anion situation or the cation situation. And this is of interest now because they're going to be different because they have different coordination environments. Fluoride is an interesting material that has a very important history. So the crystal by itself is fairly electronically dead. It doesn't do much. It's got a very, very large homo-lumo gap, and so it doesn't absorb any light and so forth. But what can happen is you can find lots of very interesting fluorite crystals in nature that are doped, that have impurities included in them, and they light up like crazy under visible or ultraviolet light. And so if you have fluorite that has, in this case, europium impurities in it, it glows this beautiful blue color. And the tendency of fluorite minerals to include light-emitting impurities led George Stokes in the mid-1800s to study fluorite, and the term fluorescence that everybody's heard of, right, originates from the fluorite mineral. Okay? The fluorite mineral has a very long history in metallurgy, but fluorescence and fluorine, the element, is named after this rock, right, this mineral, calcium fluoride. Okay. The last one that we're going to get to today before we finish up our very brief review of crystal structures is the only hexagonal structure that we're going to look at. Okay? Of course, there are hundreds of hexagonal structures that are very important and interesting, but probably the most important is the wurtzite structure. Okay? The archetypal material, again, is zinc sulfide. It's the same as in the zinc blend. Zinc sulfide can be either hexagonal or it can be cubic. Okay? The hexagonal version is just the HCP with half the tetrahedral sides filled. Remember that the zinc blend version is CCP with half the tetrahedral sides filled. So the only difference is the anion arrangement. So here's what the structure looks like with half of the tetrahedral sides, only those that are pointed up, in this case, filled. Plan view diagram. Okay. The coordination is 4 and 4, as it must be, because we have equal numbers of cations and anions. The cation coordination is tetrahedral, so is the anion, just like in the zinc blend structure. It's just the orientation of every layer is skewed, because it just bounces back and forth 180 degrees in orientation. We have two zinc sulfides per unit cell. Zinc sulfide structure, again, is very commonly found in lots of different materials. Again, very important class of semiconductor materials adopt the wurtzite structure. Most important is probably zinc oxide. Zinc oxide is, in the last, say, 20 years, been a heavily studied material in nanotechnology. And so you can make very beautiful hexagonal crystals of zinc oxide. This is a picture taken by an electron microscope of the tip of a zinc oxide nanowire. And if you look at the tip, you can see that it has this hexagonal habit to it, or this hexagonal shape. That's a direct result of the underlying crystal structure being hexagonal for zinc oxide. It also grows as wires very, very commonly because of the hexagonal crystal habit. It's got a long C-axis, and that tends to grow very, very rapidly in that direction, giving you one-dimensional structures instead of other kinds of shapes. Okay, are there any questions about what we've covered today? Next time we'll look at just two more or three more structures, and then we will move into the properties of crystals. Okay.